And I didn't initially know that I had it. I just didn't want to go nowhere. I didn't want to do anything. I just wasn't happy. Yeah, yeah, yeah,
yeah. Hey, look. You don't need no filters. You my rocket, you my perfect picture. Baby, you know I'm trying to kick it with you. Ain't gotta wait till it gets dark. We get 106 and park, you be my rock. I be your big tipper. I'm trying to show you off. I'm trying to flaunt you. I'm obsessed with ya, baby, I want ya. Let them watch ya, tell them they can tune in and show ya how we do it.
I put a love on a billboard, so you just need to look out your window.
What's going on, everybody? Welcome back to our channel. If you're new here, welcome, welcome, welcome. If you're returning, what's going on, family? How y'all doing? Go ahead and hit that subscribe button and turn on those post notifications. You heard me? Listen, guys, I am downstairs doing a little bit of cleaning. I just finished pumping not too long ago, so I am going to go ahead and clean my breastfeeding pumps. As you guys know, I usually use my LV pump, but I have been using my Medela pump. And so I'm getting ready to wash those parts up. It's been a really, really good day here in the Jackson home. I don't take it for granted that everybody is well, feeling good, and just doing good. So I'm really excited to kind of just chat with you guys, have a transparent conversation today. But before we do that, I'm gonna go ahead and get into washing these bottles up. Comment down below whether or not you use, you know, the dishwasher to wash your bottles or if you hand wash them. I hand wash them because for some reason, I just don't feel comfortable letting the dishwasher wash the baby bottles. I don't know. I mean, we use the dishwasher for everything else, but I guess just in my mind, since the babies are just so fragile, I just like to hand wash it because I know that I'm doing everything that it needs to, you know, do to get it clean. But I don't know. Comment down below if you use the dishwasher or if you hand wash the bottles. But let's go ahead and get into that. All right, guys, now that that is done, I let that stuff dry so that by the time it's time for me to pump again, all of my stuff is clean. I have to do like a routine when it comes to that since I do so much pumping, since the boys are breastfed. I latch them, but I also, you know, pump. So y'all, it's nothing like being about to feed and you realize that you didn't clean your pump part. So guys, I just finished that. So we're getting ready to head upstairs. Dad has the babies while I took care of that. And so let's go ahead and head up so that we can get into this conversation. I wanted to have this talk with you guys because I feel like we share so much with you all on our channel. And so many of you guys are like, you know, you look up to me and you love how I'm able to just manage parenthood so good and how I'm able to balance everything. And so I said, I wouldn't be real or I wouldn't be being authentic if I did not just share this piece of what's been going on in my life since having our second set of twins. But let's go ahead and head on in. Hey y'all.
How you doing?
What y'all doing?
Mateo over here asleep.
Oh, look at Mateo. Look at Milo. Hey Milo.
Say hello. You ready to put you to sleep next? Say hello.
Hey, Milo. Oh, Mr. Mateo. Look. Oh, am I waking you up, buddy? He's like, no, I'm trying to get a nap in if you don't mind.
If you don't mind. Can I get it?
All right, guys, so let me get you guys all set up, you guys. I think that's good. As y'all can see, I end up getting some bed sunburn while we were on our vacation. Comment down below like some tips your good sis can do to get that to clear up. But from what I saw, it just takes time, like, for the peeling to stop. So let's go ahead and get into this chair. Come on, baby. You smiling. Let me get your blanket. Keep back on that one.
Yep.
You good? All right, guys. So I wanted to do this video today because I feel like there's so many of you guys that look up to me and you're like, you know, I love how you balance everything. I mean, you have two sets of twins. Like, I just have one toddler or I just have one newborn and I'm struggling. Like, how do you do it? I'm so inspired. And, you know, I definitely want you guys to continue to be inspired and continue to be encouraged by just the way I do things. However, I did want to do this video just to show you guys that I, too, experience struggles. I, too, have had struggles, you know, since having my second set of twins. As you can tell from the title of this video, I'm just going to be opening up and pretty much just transparently sharing with you guys that at a point after I had our second set of twins, I did experience some form of postpartum depression. And, you know, I guess I didn't initially know that I had it until after I had my 6-week appointment. If you have had a child or if you have had children, you know that at the 6-week checkup, that's when they screen you for pretty much everything. And so they give you like this little questionnaire and it says like, have you been able to smile as much as you did before you had kids or before you gave birth? Have you been able to laugh as much as you did before you gave birth? And so I ain't gonna lie. I was just gonna lie and be like, you know what? I'm just gonna put all the answers that they want me to put so that I can just go ahead and go back home to the kids because this appointment is already, you know, taking me away from my responsibility. So let me just hurry up so I can just be done. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. And however, I was just like, I had to put some thought into it. I was like, let me just be honest and just put how I feel, you know, because these doctors, they're supposed to help me. They're supposed to give me some form of support. So let me just put how I'm feeling and, you know, see where it goes. So when I answered, you know, I put like, okay, I have not been able to smile as much as I did before. You know, I hadn't been able to, you know, I didn't feel as happy as I did before. Like, I put those things on there because that's how I was really feeling. Nothing in my life was going wrong. You know, everything was going good. Businesses were going good. Marriage was going good. Everything was going good. Just in that moment, that's how I was feeling. So I put those answers down. And when I ended up meeting with my doctor, she was like, you are, based on your screening, you are on the high end for postpartum depression. That's what your results are showing. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, at first I was like shocked. I was like, really? You know, but then the more I sat and thought about it, I was like, maybe I am. I feel like in this day and age, and I don't know if you can relate, culture teaches us, or culture puts like this thing up where no matter what's going on in your life, you're supposed to push and keep going. Mm-hmm. And I do believe you're supposed to. Mm-hmm. But I think to some degree, it has caused us to become people, some of us to become people that are functioning yet depressed. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. Yeah. So basically, it's like, you are taught to just always go no matter what, that even when you are experiencing some form of depression or something, it's like swept under the rug. It's not even mm-hmm. a big thing because
you don't ever deal with depression. You can be happy and still be depressed. You can, you know, you can laugh and still be depressed. Mm-hmm. And that's, you know, one of the things that in life we, you know, we laugh and we have fun and all of that. but we're still depressed. And that's why it's good to pray for joy, because you want God to give you joy. When you have unspeakable joy, it doesn't matter what circumstances come in your life. It doesn't matter what situations come in your life. It doesn't matter what happens. Mm-hmm. Because at the end of the day, if I'm happy, I can be happy. But as soon as a storm in my life or something comes in my life and changes my mood, it will cause my happiness to go away. But when you have joy, it doesn't matter what comes in your life. It doesn't matter what trial, tribulation, what situation, what circumstance. It doesn't matter if your baby daddy do something to your baby mama. It don't matter who comes and changes your mood. Because I will say this. It is evident that in this life, I don't care how saved you are. I don't care how Christian you are. I don't care how much you love Jesus, don't love Jesus. Your mood is going to change.
Yeah.
So at the end of the day, when you are happy, someone can come and take your happiness away. But when you have joy, can't nobody steal your joy.
Right.
No matter what you're going through.
Right. So true. So true. And as I was saying, when she told me that, you know, I was flagging for the postpartum depression, I necessarily wasn't shocked. Because like Bae said, you could be functioning and still be depressed.
Yeah. And I think your depression came from, I think you were juggling too much. You were juggling too much.
And, you know, just to start right there, I feel like, let me keep going. One thing that my doctor told me when we were having the conversation, she was like, you know what? How's everything in your life? And I told her, everything is going great. Business, marriage, everything is going good. And she asked me, like, are you trying to be superwoman, though? And when she asked that, I immediately knew, okay, this is probably what's causing me to feel this way postpartum, is trying to be superwoman. And I feel like so many of us women, we assume that role. Like, immediately after I gave birth, I started to try to do everything. Not intentionally, but I just assumed the role. Like, I was trying to, you know, care for the newborns, care for the toddlers. You know, you barely get any sleep in the beginning because you're trying to adjust to just having kids. I was embarking upon breastfeeding, and this was my first time doing that. So it was so much going on alongside businesses and alongside the other things that we were doing. And of course,
I'm just saying, and you gotta learn to ask for help, you know.
And I was gonna say that, of course, I had my husband there to help, and he was helping, but I wasn't communicating what all I needed.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel like so many of us moms, one of the reasons that we feel postpartum depression or we experience it is because we don't communicate that we need help.
Mm-hmm.
It's not necessarily that the people around us don't want to help. My husband was there helping, doing what he thought I needed, but there was different things that I did not communicate that I needed.
Mm-hmm.
You know, instead of being like, hey babe, can you do this while I take a nap because I'm tired from X, Y, and Z, I was just like, you know what, if I can do it, let me go in and do it. And I feel like for us women and moms, just because you can do it, don't mean you should do it.
That's the truth. You gotta make sure you get some help along the way. The biggest thing was communicating.
Yeah.
Because a lot of times you need help, and not only do some people communicate, but the question too, I would suggest, is your communication clear?
Right.
Because you're asking for the person to do this, do that, sometimes it's more than that. Sometimes you have to express to your spouse or whoever's helping you after giving birth what that you need help with, or that you give clear communication. Hey, listen, I'm getting burnt out in this area. I'm tired in this area. I'm losing strength in this area. Can you help? You have to make sure you're giving clear communication.
Right.
Because sometimes signals ain't enough.
Right.
You got to give clear direction, clear communication, because everybody won't catch your signal.
Right. And I think sometimes we expect our partners, our spouses, and this isn't just us moms and women, this is husbands and, you know, as well, and dads. We expect them to know or see a signal that we need help instead of just saying we need help.
Yeah.
So if you see me, I'm like getting flustered, like, oh my gosh, like, da, da, da. We expect them to be like, oh, you know, do you need help? And a lot of times they do, my husband does. A lot of times if he see me getting flustered, he'll help. But sometimes we need to do more than that. Just communicate, hey babe, I need help.
Mm-hmm. And you gotta understand too, a lot, and some people don't ask for help. And we must understand that sometimes even the caregiver needs care.
Yeah.
Even the caregiver needs care. Even the person that is giving the help sometimes need help themselves.
Mm-hmm.
And I think, you know, one thing we established, you know, and I help you to realize that, you know, you got to get that help. You got to make sure you got to stop at a certain point. Make sure you are well maintained, because you'll get so busy. And this is including life on not just parenting, but just every, you know, general life. You'll get so busy maintaining and doing the maintenance on everybody else that you don't do the maintenance on yourself.
Yes.
And if you don't learn to take care of yourself, yourself won't be around to take care of somebody else.
And that is so true. And I definitely felt like when I was going through that was my struggle. Mm-hmm. I was trying to do everything and I was not prioritizing myself. And it's easier said than done, you know? Especially as moms, we're natural nurturers. So we're just trying to just make sure everyone else stays afloat without thinking and processing the fact that we also need to make sure that we are staying afloat, because that's the only way that we can be who we need to be for everyone else.
And we're good. And you gotta do it because it helps your mental health. It plays into all factors, because if you're not careful taking care of yourself, getting the help that you need as a mom, and in general life, you can easily become toxic.
Yeah.
So what you were a help to people, now you're toxic, and you're toxic because you have not maintained yourself. You're not taking care of yourself. Mm-hmm. And you don't want to become not only sick physically, but sick spiritually, sick as a human being, because you're just in a mood where you're depressed, you're upset, and every time somebody says something to you, you just you just rude and just disgusted. I've met people like that. They're so depressed in life that they just nasty.
Yeah, they just basically, because they're so like miserable, and I don't like to say it like that, but since they're so unhappy on the inside because they haven't did a maintenance check on themselves, they're like going around messing up everyone else's day.
Yeah.
And so, you know, my doctor, she was like, instead of trying to be superwoman, how about you and your husband start being a super parents, you know? And she was like, you know, I met your husband before. He's really nice. I'm sure if you let him know that this is what you need, he'll help you. And so from there, she said, you know, if you're not feeling better, if you're not doing better, you know, within the next 3 weeks, I want to see you back again. And so I went home and talked to Babe. I actually printed out, I got them to send me my postpartum results.
Okay.
And we ended up going through them that day, remember?
Yep.
And from there, we like established like, okay, you know, I'm going to communicate when I need help. I want you guys to take from this that one, you know, if you find yourself feeling postpartum depression, because I didn't experience this with my first set. This is with my second set. Because I must say, having your second pregnancy, your second set of kids, or your second born, that life after that is so much different than how it was with your first child. Mm-hmm. Because when you bring you're bringing a new baby in while you also have tons of other responsibility.
Yeah.
So, you know, you can have postpartum depression your second pregnancy, but not have hit it your first one.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, I just want you guys to take from this to one, just communicate, ask for help. You know, maybe you don't have a partner. Maybe your baby daddy bounced on you. Like, I totally get it. But if there's people around you, whether it's your parents or your grandparents or your neighbor or your friends, because I had friends that was like, girl, listen, drop them kids off or do this and I'll help you. I didn't accept that help, you know? I wanted to continue to do it all by myself. So if you have anybody around that'll help you, communicate and you know, accept the help. Mm-hmm.
Accept the help.
Yeah.
And get the help that you need. Don't try to do it all by yourself. And this, like I say, this is general in life, you know, find you some people and your family. You know, I understand your family may be tight. You may not have nobody.
Yeah.
But find you somebody. Find you a way that you can take a break. Find you a way that you can get the help that you need.
Mm-hmm.
Don't try to. The Bible says something that is very powerful. God said in the beginning of Genesis, he said, it's not good for man to be alone. And he won't just speak because of Eve and Adam relationship. But it is not good for you as a human being and a person to do life on your own.
Mm-hmm.
And you're going to need some help along the way. And I remember real quick somebody telling me that you cannot save the whole world by yourself.
Yeah.
You need some help. That's why God put multiple people on this earth. So whatever the help that you need, get the help that you need.
Mm-hmm.
Don't do it on your own. And then when you are getting tired, just submit. even the helper needs help.
Yeah. So guys, I'm just gonna give you like three signs that I knew that I was experiencing postpartum depression, just in case you're on here and maybe you have already had your 6 week appointment and you feel like you're experiencing it now, you might be coming into it, or you just wanna check yourself now. I'll share these three with you. And then after this, we're gonna pray, because I feel like it was nothing but God that really just helped me through this. So I'll have you pray after this. But one sign that I was experiencing was, one, I just didn't want to go nowhere. I didn't want to do anything. As much as on the inside, I knew I needed to get out the house and just get some fresh air, I didn't even want to do that. I just didn't want to do anything. I just wanted to sit in the bed and just stay here and just do my normal routine. And I know it sounds crazy, because in the inside, I wanted to get out, but my mind just was like, I don't even feel like it. I didn't want to do anything that I used to enjoy. Secondly, I was definitely getting like frustrated easily, and I just wasn't happy. You know, little things would trigger me, and I would find myself upset over stuff that really wasn't a big deal, you know, when I stepped away. But it really, really bothered me in the moment. And as Bae was saying, that was really simply because on the inside, I didn't deal with what was going on. So if someone just said something that they didn't even mean to be rude, it was triggering me because I hadn't dealt with how I was feeling on the inside. And I'm trying to think of a third thing. Do you know anything like that?
No, just, you know, you get quiet. When people are depressed, they get quiet, don't want to do anything. I think you covered that. You know, kind of just staying to themselves. And like I say, you know, for us, like I was telling her, communicate. Yeah. Because you'll get the venting. And especially if you're married or in a relationship. We all got friends, so we be venting. And we don't realize sometimes that venting is a reason why we may have an action to help, or, you know.
Yeah, that's really, a good
because
one.
Because you're so busy telling everybody and going off, and you really haven't, you know, expressed the concern to your spouse or expressed the concern to the person that you need help from, instead of going and vent. Because my thing is, if you can invent, you can open up your mouth and say you and get the help that you need.
So true. And that was something that I definitely found myself doing, which we're definitely not, like I said, we're definitely not saying nothing wrong with venting, because that's what friends are for, that's what people are for.
Yeah.
But it can sometimes become toxic if you are talking so much about the situation and the person, but you never bring it to the person to actually solve your problem.
Yeah.
So it's like venting becomes more problematic than it is to actually solving your solution. So those were some things that I experienced, God. I'm sure it's more things, but I can't necessarily think of them right now. But good news is I'm doing much better. I'm feeling much better. I'm able to balance everything more efficiently. But this talk was really just to say, listen, I've experienced this too. You're not alone. Comment down below if you have any questions. But we're going to get ready to pray, and then we're going to...
Let's look to the Lord. Let us pray real quick. Lord God, we come to you, God, right now to thank you for this moment in time, God, to thank you for everyone that sits beyond this screen. God, I thank you right now for every mother that is watching. They clicked on this video. They didn't even, had even discovered this channel before, but God decided to click on this video. God, I ask that, God, you will go beyond, God, this screen and touch them from their head to the soles of their feet.
Yeah.
That God, the person, the woman that is stressed out right now, that's pulling their hair out, that's crying, and God, going in the bathroom, and just God, just feel like just giving up. God, I ask that you give them strength beyond strength. That God, you would give them healing beyond healing. That God, you would give them a miracle after miracle. You would give them blessings beyond blessings. That God, you will cause in this season that seems stressful to them, that seems, God, depressful to them, God, that seems hard, and God, that feels like it's dark. That God, I ask that in this season that you will turn things in their favor, that you will cause their cup to overflow. And God, I pray right now that God, you will change their mood, that God, you won't give them happiness. You won't let them laugh for a moment, because God, we understand happiness and laughing is just for a moment. God, I speak right now that you will give them unspeakable joy. Give them joy, 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 everlasting joy. Give them joy like never before. That when storms are coming, when storms arise, when heartaches and headaches come, and trials and tribulations and circumstances, no matter what comes, they will still have their joy. God, we thank you because, God, you gave us a joy that the world didn't give us, and the world can't take it away. God, we thank you right now, and it is in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Well, guys, we hope that you enjoyed this talk. I hope that there's something that we said that encouraged you and just helped you feel like you're not alone, you know? So, guys, this is the end. I'm Mahogany.
I'm Justin.
And listen, if you keep it locked,
we gonna show enough. Tell them my love. Come on. Come on. We gonna keep it lit. Tell them gonna keep it lit.
Y'all, Mateo, he going to sleep, so I ain't gonna do him. But guys, we'll see you in the next video.
Peace.
Never be a boy, so you just need to look out your window. Shut the whole city, I'm all yours. Let me put us on display.